we have to understand one another aspect. That is mind, intellect, emotion and ego. Manam, buddhi, siddham, ahankaram. There is one another aspect, classification with related to the function of our mind. Totally speaking, it is mind. But with related to the function of the mind, we can divide the mind into four aspects. The first one is mind, the second one is intellect, the third one is emotion or siddham or the subconscious mind, and the fourth one is ego or ahankar. So mind means we have many wandering thoughts, we have many suggestions, we have many ideas. So all the ideas, all the suggestions are known as mind. The decision out of the many ideas, we come to a conclusion or decision. The decision is known as intellect or buddhi. Buddhi or intellect is known as the deciding factor. And the emotion or the chitta, chitta or emotion is the energy for the execution of our idea, execution of our decision. And the ego is the feeling that I am doing the something. Is the ego. The ego we can deal with later in the topic, who am I? We are dealing with the ego later. The first three, mind, intellect and emotion, that we can see now. For example, we are working in a office, maybe government office. At a stretch we are having a holidays, government holidays for 5 days. And we want to spend the 5 days or 5 days of her leave. And we are having many suggestions, many ideas how to spend the 5 days leave. Our mind says we may go to a hill station, or we may go to many places, or we may entertain a repair work of our house. So in this way, our mind gives many suggestions. And out of those suggestions, we have to select one. We cannot execute all the suggestions. So the suggestive part of our mind is known as mind. And the deciding factor, deciding aspect of our mind is known as the buddhi or intellect. So we have to select one. So whatever we have select, for our selection, we have to have some energy to execute. For that, our chitta or the subconscious mind, that has to give energy for that. So there is no problem to understand what is mind, the suggestive part, there is no problem. And the decision making mind is known as the intellect, there is also a problem. But what is the relationship between the intellect and the emotion? That alone is the important thing we have to understand. For example, we are walking in our street. 100 meters away from ourselves, there is a crowd. We are seeing the crowd is standing there. From here we cannot know why the crowd is being there, what are they doing, we cannot understand from here. பரமசிவம் நீங்கள் மற்றதெல்லாம் பிறகு பார்த்துக்கலாம், நீங்கள் கரில் உட்காருங்க, நீங்கள் மற்றதெல்லாம் பிறகு பார்க்க. So we cannot understand from here because 100 meters away, the crowd is 100 meters away from us. We do not know what they are doing there, why they are crowding there, we do not know. So the mind says, we have to go there and look what is going on there. The mind suggests like this. The same mind suggests another thing. The crowd does not look normal. It seems to be an abnormal crowd. The persons standing there seems to be some unwanted elements. It is unnecessary for us to go there. We have to avoid the place. We have to go away somewhere else. So the one part of our mind says we have to go to the crowd. The other part of our mind requires that we have to avoid the crowd. So the both suggestions are contradictory. We have to select out of the two contradictory desires, contradictory ideas, we have to select one. The intellect has to select one. For example, if the intellect select the first suggestion, for example, what is the first suggestion? We have to go to the crowd. So if we select the first suggestion to go to the crowd, what kind of energy is required to go to the crowd? Some interest, some anxiety is necessary to activate ourselves to go to the crowd. So the energy portion or the subconscious mind creates the interest or anxiety upon us to go to the crowd. So we go to the crowd. Suppose the intellect select the second option. What is the second option? The second option is to avoid the crowd. We have to go away from the crowd. So what kind of energy is needed to go away from the crowd? The fear or some tension or anything, some aversion. If we have the fear or aversion upon the crowd, then we avoid the crowd. So if we take the decision that we have to avoid the crowd, the fear or some aversion will come. That will be supplied by the emotional mind or the subconscious mind. So it will be supplied. So in this way, so whatever be the decision, according to that, the energy will flow like that. So decision maker alone is the important role. That means the intellect or buddhi is the important role. And whatever may be the decision, the energy will follow. The energy will not have any idea. The energy will not have any decision. So it will follow the idea, follow the decision produced by the intellect. So whatever may be the decision, the energy will flow like this. So the regulated portion is only to the intellect. So whenever we are having a plan or anything in our world, in our activities, we have some decision. So if you have the correct decision, the correct energy will flow. So you need not to struggle with the energy. The energy will follow the decision. So we have to deal with the decision of our according to the circumstances. So our concern must be to the decision. If you are take the correct decision, correct energy will flow. So you need not worry about the energy. Energy will follow. we need not worry about anything with related to this kind of energy I don't like, this kind of energy I like. We cannot have any choice. But we can decide. So for this, for the external psychological world is concerned, where if it is purely psychological, there is no division like that, manam, buddhi, siddha, mahankar, or mind, intellect, emotion, or ego. There is no division at all. If it is purely psychological, here totally everything is mind. Whether it is form in the form of energy, whether it is in the form of intellect, whether it is in the form of ego, everything is totally mind. Everything is one. There is no classification. But whenever we are related to the external world, external situation, we have to decide, we have to classify into four aspects. Then only we can have our action in a good way. So in the external world is concerned, we may have some philosophy, we may have some good philosophy, and we can follow the philosophy, we can have some principles, how to live, how, what kind of life we can have, what kind of arrangement we can have in our life, that we can have. But in the external world is concerned, we can arrange the life, arrange the pattern, arrange the situations and everything. But in a, thereby we can have justice, we can have some discipline. For in the external world is concerned, discipline is necessary, justice is necessary, some good thing is necessary. But here some principles, some scriptures say how to deal with the society. They propose three kind of principle known as Maitri, Karuna, Upeksha. Maitri means relationship. Karuna means some love. Upeksha means getting away from something. So relationship means when we are related, for example, if somebody is our relative, our approach will be somewhat different. For example, we have some boy of the next house enter into our house and broken down our glass bureau. What will we do? We will be anger upon the person, we will shout upon the person, we will try to do some harm to the person. But at the same time, if our own boy, our son, as a little boy around the age of 6 or 7, he is doing some mischief and he is breaking down our glass bureau, we will control, but at the same time, we will not harm the boy. Instead of harming the boy, we will control the action. Here, because we are related to our boy, but we are not related to the other boy. So some connection of love is between our boy and ourselves. But we are having no love with the other boy, with the other person. So here, we have to understand, we have to take everybody is related to ourselves. We have the philosophy like this. If we have the philosophy like this, naturally the emotion will be like this. Because we have some decision. The intellect have a decision that everybody is related. Then we come to a thing like this. The relationship, when we establish a relationship between the other person, naturally some unnecessary thing will not come. Some unnecessary emotion will not come. And I have read a book related to some mystical thing. There they referred an instance, referred a matter where a person has some problem with his neighbor. The neighbor is also a powerful person. So he cannot directly do anything, any harm to the other person. So he wants to execute a black magic against the other person, the neighbor. He seeks the help of a person who has the power to do some black magic. He approaches the person and asks him to do some wrong to the neighbor. And the neighbor has some capacity to have some vision upon the other person's life history. And he told the neighbor, in the previous birth, the neighbor was your son, own son. But in this birth, he happened to be your neighbor and happened to be your enemy. And in your previous birth, he was your son. Shall I do any harm to him? He asked like this. So he abandoned the effort to do such harm through black magic. So here he established a relationship. Previously he has actually some problem, physically some problem is there. But anyhow, he established a relationship somewhere or other. He established a relationship. So by establishing a relationship between the other person, our temperament, our energy, everything changes. So that is the meaning for the first one, the Maitri. And Karuna, that means love, that is, we can feel, very well. Because when you have the relationship with other person, when we have the feeling of Maitri, when you have the feeling of relationship, naturally the Karuna, the love will come. And the other thing is that we have to get away from other something. So something is not suitable for ourselves to act. If it is manageable to go along with that, if it is not permitted to go along with that, we have to get away from that. So that is one of the principles. So thereby we are minimizing the unnecessary trouble. So when we minimize the unnecessary trouble, naturally the unnecessary energy flow also will minimize. So this is related to the external world is concerned. Even though it is related to our psychological structure, settling the outer situation to a certain level, it will helpful to deal with the psychological factor also. But anyhow, we should not have any idea that we should control our mind, control our emotion totally. So that is a different aspect. But when we deal with the situation, the unnecessary emotion will also create some harm. So we have to deal with the situation in a intellectual way. If you have the decision in an intellectual way, thereby some necessary emotion alone will come. So that is why some indirectly you are dealing with your emotion also. But doesn't matter. But if you are dealing with the external situation, thereby you may also deal with your emotion. But it is not just direct venture to saturate your mind perfect in a perfect condition. Keeping the mind in a perfect condition is not the goal. But the main thing is that we have to have a good relationship with the society, good relationship with the circumstances, good relationship with the problem we are having, because some controversial persons are, we have to live with some controversial persons. Some unnecessary problem may come. So here we may have some principle, we may have some philosophy, we may have some order or discipline to separate everything. This is only to deal with the external world. But it is not directly deal with ourselves. So direct psychological world is concerned, the only one idea is alone. We have to be without any work psychologically. Psychologically everything is good, nothing is bad. But in the legal studies, there is a legal maxim, because we cannot, in the olden days, the law has been, the England has given the law and everything, and in England, the king is the main person, and no law can punish a king. The king can punish anybody, but no law can punish a king. So they have a legal maxim, king can do no wrong. That is the legal maxim. That means whatever he has done, it is not at all a wrong. So the king can do no wrong. That is the legal maxim. Because no law can be, with no law, a king cannot be punished. So in this way, psychologically, everybody is the king. So we cannot do any wrong. But it is not applicable to the physical world. Physically, something is good, something is bad. Something is right, something is wrong. So here we have to set right everything. But psychologically, we need not set right anything. Psychologically, we have to come to a conclusion, everything is natural, everything is good, everything is okay. So we have to give okay to the psychological world. But it does not mean all activities of the world is not good, is good. So something may be good, something may be bad. We have to correct. If it is bad, we have to correct. If it is right, we have to encourage the right thing. So the way of life, we have to arrange. But we should not arrange our psychological world. We have to give okay to everything. When we give liberation to the psychological world, with our mind, the total mind becomes a liberated mind. Otherwise, the mind becomes a struggling mind. If you regulate the mind, it is an unnecessary job. Even how many life you can take, you cannot set right the mind. The mind will be like this. We cannot set right the waves of the sea. It will be like that. But at the same time, whenever we give freedom to our mind, the total mind will be in a freedom, in the liberated mind. So the liberated mind is a different kind of mind. It is just like a living river where nothing will stay there, everything will be washed away. Ungalude kelvigal padal irundha? And one another topic with related to this one is that the thought and thinking. What is thought and what is thinking? Once somebody was affected by a problem. He was a government servant. Some meeting was going on. And the presiding officer was his superior officer. He was presiding over the meeting. During the meeting is on progress, the cell phone of the concerned person has ringed. After feeling the noise of the cell phone, he immediately switched off the phone. But anyhow, the presiding officer give him a punishment of transfer. How he can attend the meeting without put off the cell phone? So saying he has given a punishment transfer. And the government servant felt very sorrowful. So the punishment is very too much and it is out of range. It may be wrong, but it is a mistake on the part of the government servant. He must have put the cell phone on silence mode or anything. But anyhow, he has not attended the call. He had immediately, whenever it has rang, he has immediately put off the cell phone. And he might have given a memo or anything. And he might have given an explanation, sought for an explanation. But instead of that, it is wrong for him to have the punishment transfer. So thinking like that, he suffered psychologically, and he has no sleep in the night. And he cannot eat well. He feels a tension in his mind, and he asked how to deal with the problem. So whenever he was tried to sleep, the thought goes on, and he immediately responds, I have to deal something, I have to do something upon the superior officer. How dare he was to deal with, give you a punishment like this? He thinking like that. He wants some solution from me. So here I attended the problem. So we have to understand what is the difference between thought and thinking. So when we are affected by some good situation or bad situation, naturally the thought related to the situation comes repeatedly. That is natural. So if you are affected in a bad situation, so the concerned person was also affected by the bad situation, so some related thought comes naturally. So when it comes naturally on its own, it is known as thought. But if he is riding upon the thought and he want to do some harm to the other person or anything, if he ride upon the thoughts, we are making the thought into thinking. So the conscious attention, the conscious activities upon the thought or anything is known as thinking. So thinking is manual. And all thoughts it is automatic. It happens on its own. But thinking is in our hand. Thought is not in our hand. But it happens unconsciously. So when the situation is like this, naturally some thought will pop up on its own again and again. But when we begin to ride upon the thought, we have to do something, we have to do this thing or that thing, then we are giving strength to the thought. Otherwise, if you do not make the thought into thinking, all the thought will go away very soon from us. But whenever we convert the thought into thinking, it will not go away from us easily. It will acquire some strength, and it will give you some pressure and psychological stress, and we make the situation as a complicated one. So for example, if the person wants to set right the transfer order, will go to some court or some tribunal or anything, then he have to think. But here he is not having any decision to go to the court or any action, legal action against the order. But in that condition, there is no necessity to make the thought into thinking. So he is unnecessarily make the thought into thinking and get the position into a complicated one. So if you step away from the thinking, then everything will be all right. And there was a similar situation when I gone to Coimbatore, where a family of a doctor came to me. Their problem somewhat serious, but the solution was the same. Their problem is that they have only one son, and as a child of 1.5 years, the child has died. The doctor told me it is a great sorrow in our life, but anyhow I managed. But they came to me after six months after the death. Anyhow, I managed. But my wife cannot get away from the sorrow. She has developed many psychological and physical problems out of the sorrow. What we have to do? Here also, the problem is same. The solution is same. The thought and thinking. Because that is a great sorrow in a family. Naturally, the thought will come like this. We cannot control. But whenever we ride upon the thought, it is good for ourselves, it is the good for a parent to get the sorrow like this. If you develop any thinking like that, this or that, this way or that way, if you convert the thought into thinking, then it become strength, the strength will be acute. The strength will be more and more powerful. So here, when everything is in the form of thought, even though it is painful, it will leave away from us very soon. But whenever we convert the thinking, thought into thinking, it will get more powerful. And it will create more problem within ourselves, within the psychological and as well as in the physical manner. So, leaving everything in the thought form, not converting everything into the thinking, all thoughts will be pass away just as a passing cloud. Even though it may come repeatedly, soon it will go away. And if you want any question regarding to this, you may ask.
Thinking is required for executing action.
In the external world is concerned, thinking is a must. Without thinking, you should not expect a thought. The thought may come or may not come. But thinking alone is necessary. But external world is concerned, action is concerned, thinking is a must. We have to think. Intellect, decision make.
Like in the crowd, you say you can either go near the crowd, you can go back home.
Mm.
So suppose we are taking a decision that we are going back home. After going back home, our mind will say, why not we have gone to the crowd and seen and then come back to home? Even after taking decision, there will always be a kind of.
So here, mind will say many things like this, it suggests like this, this and that, but what you decide is that. What we are, if you...
If we have come back to home, but still, why we came,
we could
have gone to the crowd and seen what happened.
But even though it is, mind is taking, say, thinking like that, no energy will come. But in that circumstances itself, your mind takes the form of the intellect. And I heard it is good to go to the crowd. Then only the energy, the interest will come, and you will go there, and you will meet the consequences there.
So the energy is not applied there, but still there will be a thought.
So when we take this is like that. This is mind. This is not the intellect. So when we do contradictory aspect, contradictory suggestion, if it is saying like this, it is not intellect, it is mind. So mind will be say something like that. So if the intellect takes a decision to go something and not to go something, so if it is goes here and there, then some good decision will not be there. If your decision is there, then only the energy will be there. Otherwise, the confusion alone will be there.
So you talked about this boy who is 6 years old and broken the glass cabinet.
Six years?
There's a boy who is a young boy who has broken the glass cabinet. The incident.
Hmm.
Then you talked about Maitri, Karuna and Upekha. So you said that, I couldn't understand this.
So here, you can see the difference between your son and the other person. So with related to your own son, your approach will be different. For example, if the other boy of the next door broken your glass bureau and got some injury on her hand, so what will you think? It is right for him to get some injury like this. You will think like that. But if it is your own son, you will not worry about the broken bureau. You will care for his wound alone, because your concern, you have more concern with your own child. So here, the relationship between your child and yourself is love. Is a love, but you have no love with the other person. So here, what is required here is that if you consider everybody as your related person, naturally the love has to come. So the criteria is to consider here is that whether there is the existence of love is there or not. So if you are related, the love will be there. If you are not related, the love will not be there. So if you consider everybody as a lovable person, as a related person, then the love will be there, some connection will be there, some love will be there. So the love alone is there. The love alone is the important thing. Then only we will have some good circumstances. Otherwise, some enmity alone will be there. Instead of love, some enmity will be there.
So what about karuna and upekha?
What about? Karuna. Karuna means love. Upeksha means getting away from that. For example, we cannot, some friends may be there. You cannot control him, make him in an order, in a good order. So you have to get away from them.
So as per what I have studied about these four, they are called Brahma Viharas. There is Maitri, Karuna, Upeksha and Mudita.
The three. You studied.
Yeah. Oh. So
the fourth one is?
Mudita. Mudita. That means I'm very happy. For example, if she wins a prize, I'm very happy for her. That is
Mudita. Diditsha, I think.
Okay. Oh, right. So my mind is wandering between what you are saying and what my concept is telling me, what I've understood.
No. Maybe. So you are happy, it is also a good thing. If you are happy always, everything will be good.
Right.
So it may be.
The name of this example is what exactly? You gave the example of this.
When you will be happy when you are related to other person. When you are not related to the other person, you will not be happy. So the main thing is that you will have establish some relationship with the other person. That is the first thing. If you are execute the first thing, it incorporate the remaining aspect also.
What I understood is the
good for yourself and good for the society. For the external actions, you can apply these principles. For psychological thing, we should not try to apply any principle. We have to understand everything is natural.
But for the physical world,
we can apply this. Okay. So when you are the first step applicable to everything, so that is the first step. Psychologically, if you are free, then you are capable to meet with anything, any circumstances you can capable. But all the principle also very easy for to follow. If the Maitri, Karuna, Upeksha, Didiksha, anything that you can follow very easily. But psychologically, you have to be free. You have no idea to make yourself. You have to design. You should not free from the idea of designing yourself psychologically.
So, but will it lead to dissolution of ego as one of the mondial
So everything will be there. There is no ego. There is no give importance. We need not give importance to the ego. When you psychologically, if you are speaking, there is only thing. Mind alone is the. It includes everything, including ego. So we have to give total freedom to the mind. There you need not divide the mind into mind, manam, buddhi, siddham, ahankaram. You need not divide. You totally as mind. You totally take it as one. Everything will, because when we free from psychological, when you are free, you become a child. So whenever you are become a child, you can very easily move with anything. Okay.
To stop thoughts becoming thinking, what level of mind we have to decide? Like, do we need to use our intellectual, or how do we do that?
So we need not connect many things. So when we speak about thought and thinking, we have to restrict ourselves within the two end alone. One thought, whether it is in the form of thought or whether we are converting the thought into thinking. So when the external world is concerned, thinking is necessary. So this is a different classification. That classification, intellect, mind, intellect, emotion, that is a different classification. For this classification, only thought and thinking alone is there. Here, whether you are in thought or thinking. So the thought is unconscious and natural, but thinking alone is conscious and artificial and manual. And here, the problem is very psychological one. You need not convert the thought into thinking. Thought may come repeatedly, but whenever we want to have some external work, you have to think. Otherwise, if you saturate the psychological one, then thinking is not necessary.
How do we stop that? How do we stop?
If you try to stop anything, it is also against a thinking. So you are encouraging thinking. So we have to understand everything is natural, it will be like that. Thought alone, we need not worry about the thought. It is natural, we have to find it is natural. All thoughts are natural. Whoever in that position, the thought will be like that. You have to come to the conclusion like this. But if you unconsciously ride upon a thought, it doesn't matter. But whenever you are conscious that you are unconsciously riding upon a thought, the moment you conscious of that, you will step down from that. You need not further. So thinking means you are moment by moment you are renewing the thinking. Then only you continue thinking. Otherwise, even you are entered into your thinking, the next moment it also becomes a thought. So you need not worry about the thinking. But moment by moment, you need not renew your thinking. That alone is enough. Involvement, conscious involvement.
We are aware that the thought is becoming thinking, we just don't involve.
Yeah.
Drop the involvement.
We have to function, allow the natural function of itself. In the next session, we are dealing with the who am I. And before that, you may also prepare any question you may in your mind, you may take a notes and you may ask the question with later to the things we have seen already. But with later to the new topic, you need not prepare any question, but within the old topic with which we have already covered, we can take any question and you can ask. See the topic, who am I? If you go through the Vedantic text, you will see many things, how all the lives are created, how the universe is created, how five elements were created, and everything was described. But they don't insist that you have to know them for yourself. I have to tell you, you have to understand, you have to know this is this, this is that. They do not give us any responsibility to know them for ourselves. But they give one responsibility. You have to understand yourself as Atma. Because you are Atma, you are the soul, the self. You have to realize that you are the Atma. And the Vedanta scriptures describe, you are not the body, you are not the mind, you are pure Atma. You have to understand yourself as the Atma, the Atman. And if you look into the teachings of Ramana Maharishi, he will also used to give the same thing. You have to understand, you have to inquire who you are, who am I, and find out you are the Atman. You have to get Atma Sakshatkar. So we have to have some idea about what is Atma, what is the real self, what is soul. We have to have a glimpse, we have to have an idea about what is Atma, what does the meaning of Atma. For example, we are sitting in a dark room. Everything is dark, nothing is visible. We bring a candle. In the candle light, we can see all the objects of the room. All things are visible with the help of the candlelight. If there is no candlelight, we cannot see anything in the room. Everything is utter darkness. To see the things, the candlelight is very useful, the candlelight is necessary. So if you want to see the candlelight, do you need one another candlelight to see this candlelight? No, we need not have any another candlelight, because the candlelight is self-evident in nature. It expresses itself. It shows itself. It reveals itself. But other things are having no capacity to reveal itself. The candlelight alone has the capacity to reveal itself. So those which is having the self-evident nature is known as the chit or the some life energy or some in the name of consciousness. So the consciousness alone, the life energy alone has the self-evident nature. For example, we are walking in a dark night and we dashed upon a stone or a wall and we got some injury upon the forehead. We feel the pain of the wound. We feel the pain of the injury. How do you feel? How do you know? the pain. Do you feel it with the help of a candlelight? No, no candlelight is there. It is utter darkness. But anyhow, we feel the pain. So the pain is self-evident in nature. It expresses itself. So in this way, we have a problem. And we have some tension because of the problem. We have the tension in our mind. We feel some pain in our mind. How do you know? How do you know the pain of your mind? Do you know it with the help of a candlelight? No. The pain is a self-evident, the pain is also self-evident in nature. So in the physical aspect, the physical pain is also self-evident. The psychological pain is also self-evident. The first one is known as physical consciousness or bodily consciousness. The second one is psychological consciousness. So the both have self-evident in nature. We physically know the feeling, we psychologically feel the feeling. It expresses itself, all the pain, pain of the psychological structure, pain of the body expresses itself, it shows the pain, it reveals the pain. For example, we are sitting in a park. In front of us, there is a huge tree. It is open. Anybody can see the tree. It is very huge tree. It is evident. Nobody can deny whether it is real or not. It is real. It is really standing before us. But if you close our eyes, the tree has disappeared. But in the same way, we are having physical pain, we are having psychological pain. Can you hide the pain as you hide the tree by closing your eyes? Can you hide the pain? Can you hide the pain of your mind? Can you hide the pain of your body? We cannot. So those which cannot be hid, those which cannot be denied, its existence is known as consciousness. So the bodily consciousness and psychological consciousness cannot be hid. It is self-evident. This self-evident nature cannot be hid by anything. It is evident. The scriptures say we have to understand the difference between the Atma and Anatma. We have to know the difference between Atma and Anatma. Atma is the self. Atma is the real self. And Anatma is the non-self. That which is not Atma is known as Anatma. Here we see in front of us we see the tree, huge tree. In this way we look at the vast world. And if we close our eyes, the world will be disappear. We can hear some sound. If we close our ear, the sound will go away. The whole world whether it is anatma, the appear and disappear, whether it is anatma, and the consciousness that cannot be hid, whether it is atma. But the Shastra said that the consciousness alone is anatma. The bodily consciousness and psychological consciousness both are anatma. That false. That is not real. He comes to say something beyond the consciousness itself. That is atma. So what is the role of atma and what is the role of consciousness? We are having psychological consciousness, we are having physical consciousness that we feel, we know very well. It is self-evident in nature. Nothing can hide it. But the scriptures say they are false, they are not real. Something more, something beyond consciousness is there, that is atma. So they say the atma is awareness. They give a name to atma, awareness. Awareness is the name for atma. And what is awareness and what is consciousness? What is the difference between awareness and consciousness? For example, we put some sweet in our tongue. We feel the sweetness. The sweetness we cannot hide. It is self-evident in nature. We feel the sweetness. And afterwards, we put some bitter one. And we feel the bitter taste. If you touch some iceberg, we will feel cold. In the same way, if we heat some hot water, we feel the hot. What has turned into the different kind of taste? What has turned into different kind of feeling, hot or cold? So our tongue has a sensitivity. Our body has a sensitivity. But with the sensitivity you cannot feel. The sensitivity of the tongue you cannot feel. The sensitivity of the tongue has turned into the taste of sweetness and bitterness. The sensitivity of the body has turned into hot and cold. But the very sensitivity itself is nice. It is not sweetness or bitterness. It is not a cold one, it is not a hot one. It is beyond both. But itself has turned into different kind of taste, different kind of feeling. So the basic structure, that is the cause for the consciousness, that is the original state for consciousness, is known as awareness. This original sensitivity is awareness. But we cannot feel. When it turns into the form, take the form of a consciousness, then alone we can feel. But the consciousness has a beginning and end. It forms and disappears. The sweetness comes and disappears. The bitterness comes and disappears. That is anidya. That means appearance and disappearance. It is not a permanent one. It is a temporary one. But we cannot measure the consciousness, the awareness beyond as the basis of our consciousness. We cannot feel, we cannot measure what is the real status of our consciousness, awareness, what is the real state of our awareness. We cannot feel, we cannot measure. Because there is no apparatus to measure the awareness. We can measure the consciousness, but we cannot measure the awareness. But we can infer. The consciousness, as just like a wave in the sea, it just forms. But the entire ocean is beyond the waves, basis of the waves. But it is the custom of our teaching of the scriptures, giving importance to the Atma. But many suffered as if we have to understand, we have to feel Atma itself. But it is impossible. And somebody asked Ramana Maharishi, "You are insisting to get Atma Sachatkar. We have to understand, we have to feel Atma. Is it possible to feel Atma? How can we feel through sensory organ or through our mind? How can we feel? How can we know? How can we taste Atma? Whether it is possible to feel through our sensory organ?" So he simply denied, we cannot feel Atma through sensory organ, we cannot feel through our mind. Then they asked, then how can we feel Atma, how can we taste Atma? So he simply turned his statement, nobody can feel Atma, nobody can taste Atma. We'll say like that as if we have to, we had feel Atma, but no one can feel Atma, no one can taste Atma. But it is there, we can infer. As an inference, we can have Atma. Then why scriptures and many saints give importance to the Atma as if we have to feel Atma? So this is a strategy to step down from our consciousness. They are by giving importance to Atma means we should deny the consciousness. So the denying the consciousness alone is important. Not feeling and enjoying, tasting the Atma is unimportant. But it is impossible. But their statement related to the Atma is means only to the denial of our consciousness. Psychological and physical, everything is coming and going. It is a temporary one. We should not rely upon our reliability upon the conscious level. There may be in many kind of experience. All experiences are in the form of consciousness. Some what kind of experience, some good experience, bad experience, all experiences are consciousness. Everything comes and goes. Everything is anidya or everything is temporary. We should not give importance to that. We should not struck up with our conscious experience. So that is the crux of the teaching for giving importance to the Atma. Actually, giving importance to Atma does not mean that we have to taste Atma. We should not feel Atma. It is impossible. But the main thing is that we have to be free from the consciousness, because the freedom, liberation is not related to the Atma. It's related to the consciousness. If you do not give importance to the consciousness goes on freedom. The liberation is related to the conscious level. It has no connection to Atma. But giving importance to Atma is a strategy to neglect the consciousness, conscious experiences. So there is the olden style of the scriptures. But we need not rely upon this way of approaching, but many persons are searching Atma. I ought to taste Atma, I will have to feel Atma. In this name of tasting Atma, they are wasting their entire life. They are searching after self, life after life they are searching. But it is impossible. But the main theme, main crux for the teaching related to the Atma is that we have to disregard the conscious experiences. That is the important thing. And if we give freedom to the consciousness, but if we think it is permanent, we can seek something, some conscious experience. But nothing is permanent. Everything is transient. Whatever comes, the next moment it will go away. And that is the healthy way of our approach. That is related to the consciousness. And in the yoga process, the concentration with related to the eye consciousness is considered to be the supreme one. And if you concentrated upon the eye consciousness, so there it is a good kind of meditation. Thereby you can have some energy field, we can create some energy field, we can feel some energetic or some occult power, many experiences, anything may happen. For the purpose of attaining something, you can do such kind of practice. Otherwise, it is not important. But we are also giving importance to the eye consciousness in a different way. What is the role of I am in our approach? We feel I am existing, I am living, I am as a human being, we know ourselves as I am. When we are in a deep sleep, do you have the feeling of I am? We have no feeling of I am. When we are in conscious way, conscious world, we feel we are alive. We have the feeling of I am. But in the sleep itself, if we have dream, in the dream state also, the I am is available. We feel I am when we are sleeping, when we are dreaming. In the waking, I am living, I am having some experience. So you feel the feeling of I am. So what is common in the waking hours and in the dream state? Our thought alone is the common factor available in both the cases. So the thought alone is the reason for our eye consciousness. If there is no thought, there is no I am. In the deep sleep, there is no thought. So in the samadhi state, there is no thought. So whenever thought enters, the eye consciousness will be there. So the eye consciousness is the reason, the thought alone is the reason for the eye consciousness. If there is no thought, there is no eye consciousness. Moreover, the thought functions as a habit of creating the eye consciousness. For example, you look at a tree, the thought enters and it de-explains. It explains it whole, it is a tree. At the same time, it shows you as yourself. Somebody is looking at the tree. At one side, it creates the tree. It colors, it creates the tree. Then at the other end, it creates a picture for yourself as the seer of the tree. So it always creates some duality. Each and every segment of your thought, some duality will be there, the observer and the observed. Without the duality, the thought cannot function. Each and every moment, it will function in duality alone. And with, for example, if you walk along the road, some bus is coming in front of you. When you look at the bus, you immediately recognize, so you are in front of the bus. You recognize yourself and you recognize the bus itself. So then only you can move away from the bus. So you have to understand, you have to differentiate the bus from yourself. Then only you can act. So in the physical world, the separation is important, the separation is necessary. So you have to understand the bus is away from you and you are away from the bus. So you have to feel a separation. Then only you can act what you have to do, what you should not do. Where you have to turn away, where you have to step down, step away. But the same thought takes a dangerous role within ourselves. Externally it is okay. But psychologically, it creates a nuisance within ourselves. When we have some fear, when we have some anger, you create the ownership that I am having the anger, I am having the fear. Actually, psychologically, there is one experience alone. There cannot be any dual experience. Each and every moment, a single experience alone is possible. But the thought creates a duality within a single experience, as a experience and the experiencer. And the experience takes a responsibility to free from the fear, free from the anger, free from the sorrow. So it is an artificial responsibility, some unnatural responsibility. Actually, each and every moment, new thought alone has come. There cannot be any old thought. Moment by moment, new thought alone can come. So the new thought creates a new experiencer. The new thought creates a new experience. Moment by moment, the experience goes away, the experiencer also goes away. There cannot be any constant experiencer, but the thought holds the experience as a common man from the childhood onwards. Some continuous eye consciousness is available here. But actually, it is a momentary one, created by the momentary thought. But our memory pattern gives a continuity as if you are existing from childhood onwards, you are existing as a single person. And for whom some different kind of experience comes and goes. Actually, the experiencer comes from the experience. When we have the anger, the thought creates a person who is having anger. When we are having a fear, the thought creates a person who is having the fear. The experience comes from the experience. Not the experiencer has created any experience. Moment by moment, according to the circumstances, some experience comes. And the thought enters and creates a color as an experiencer and experience. And it is okay with the external world. In the external world, we have to differentiate everything, the experiencer and the experience, the observer and the observer, then only we can function. We can walk away from the bus and do the necessary thing. We have to separate everything. But if we separate ourselves within ourselves, I have to be free from my emotion, I have to keep my emotion with myself always. If it is a good emotion, I have to keep with me forever. If it is a bad emotion, we have to get away from the emotion. So in this way, we are inviting a struggle within ourselves. Thereby, the eye consciousness takes a responsibility to deal with ourselves. Actually, psychologically, there is no responsibility. So when there is no responsibility, whatever comes will go away in the next moment. Only because of the wrong responsibility, we try to regulate ourselves within ourselves. There are many stories to explain this statement. In our scriptures, we can see. Once a saint was doing some meditation on the bank of a river. The other side of the river, some village is there, some village women taking some milk materials to sold the nearby village in the this side of the river. That is the usual custom. The villagers from the other side come crossing the river, because the river was very, very shallow. They can walk crossing the river by walking itself. They can cross the river and sell the milk materials to these persons and return in the evening crossing the same river again. It is a really daily routine. One day, when they come this side, the river was very shallow. It is very easy for them to cross the river by walking. When they have to return in the evening, because of some new water new rain, some flood is there in the river. So they cannot cross the river. So they seek the help of the saint who is doing meditation on the bank of the river. And the saint told them, "I am very hungry. Please give me something for my food. I will help you." And the villagers give him the remaining food materials, and he ate everything. And after eating everything, he goes near the river and says to the river, "If I have not ate anything, please give me the way for the persons." And the river also give way to the persons, as if understand, approve that he has not ate anything. But after the villagers has gone away crossing the river, and the saint was sitting for meditation, and the disciple asked a question. "In front of us you ate everything, but you asked the river that you have not eaten anything, and you told that I have not eaten anything, and you please give me the way, give way to the persons. What happened here?" So the reason is to explain this statement. Because each and every moment, the new I consciousness is there. When the saint eating something, some I consciousness is there. But it goes away. After the eating is over, the I consciousness goes away. So when he goes near the river, new I consciousness is there. The new I consciousness has not eaten anything. So moment by moment, the I consciousness is new. To tell the message, they created this story like this. But it is purely applicable to the psychological world alone. It is not to the physical world. For example, you borrowed some amount to your neighbor and saying that I will give you return tomorrow, next day. And the next day the neighbor came to you to get back the amount. You cannot say the person who has received the amount has gone yesterday itself, new person is here, I cannot refuse to repay it. So physically you are the same person from childhood onwards, you are the same person. But psychologically, moment by moment we are new. But if you try to be an old person, we take some responsibility to deal with something for the future. So all future, present, past, everything comes when you have a continuity for yourself. But psychologically, moment by moment, you are new. The old has gone. The each and every present moment alone, some present eye consciousness is there. It is a momentary one. So when we are momentary, we should not have any responsibility. So psychologically, we have to be free with ourselves. If you hold yourself as somebody, as a continuous one, there is a real bondage for yourself. You are binding yourself as somebody, as a continuous person. That is the bondage. That is a psychological bondage for yourself. So you have to be free from yourself. The old, the new I has to be free from the new I, old I. So moment by moment, you are a momentary I consciousness. And psychologically, each and every moment, some experience comes, the next moment experience goes. There cannot be any permanent experience. Moment by moment, new experience alone is there. And when the thought enters, it creates the experience and experiencer. But it doesn't matter. But when we give importance to the eye consciousness, the experiencer as a role, to saturate yourself, saturate your experience, then only the problem starts. So if you have the idea to establish yourself in a good state, then the eye takes a role, the eye takes a responsibility. If you don't have any idea to saturate yourself, whatever it be, you have to go along with that. Then the experience, the responsibility of the eye consciousness also goes away. Just like the experience goes away, the experiencer also goes away. So psychologically, we must be like a living river. Moment by moment, new water alone has to come. New experience alone has to come. New thought alone has to come. There should not be any old. Actually, really, new thing alone is there. We think we are a continuous one, we are a past one, we are going toward a future one. But the present, past, future, everything, even for the external world is concerned, is a must. We have to plan for the future. We have to consider the past. We have to consider the past knowledge. We have to move towards the future. We have to safeguard the future. We have to get some lesson from the past. We have to gather many ideas from the past. That is purely good for the external world. But the psychological world is quite opposite. Here, freedom alone is the role. We should not shape anything. We should not plan anything. I must be like that. I should not be like this. So there is no choice. There should not be any selection. There should not be any comparison. So it is only purely psychological. The psychological world is different and the physical world is different. But see, if you psychologically free, if you psychologically don't have any idea, psychologically don't have any philosophy to hold yourself, that is liberation. Liberation is our natural state. You need not create. If you create something, you have to lose it. But it is a natural state, you cannot lose it. Even though you lose it, it will be there. You may not aware of that, but it is there, already there. When we were a child, we are in the same state. Only because of our intellect, only because of the grown up of our intellect, our innocence has gone away. Actually, the liberation is an innocent state of our mind. The innocent state of our mind and liberation is not different. Both are same. Here, our knowledge alone is the enemy. Our understanding is that we have to let it free. We do not know anything. We have to let the mind operate on its own, as if we have no idea. But all our idea, all our philosophy, all everything is only related to the external. External world, you can plan, you can do anything. You can correct anything, you can change anything, you can remodel anything. But here, you have psychologically, you have to accept yourself totally, wholeheartedly. So that you have to decide, that you have to find out, that you have to understand. If you understand, the understanding will operate and nothing more is needed. You may have a different kind of emotion, different kind of quality, different kind of mindset. But in spite of all those things, you have to accept yourself totally, wholeheartedly. You need not wait. My character has to change, then only I can get enlightenment. My temperament has to go, my temperament has to change. Nothing is needed. In spite of all those things, at any time, if you accept you wholeheartedly, that's the end of it. You might have know something or may not know something about the auction sale. There is some difference between the ordinary sale and auction sale. For example, if you purchase a product in a shop and take it to the house and find some problem in the product, you can go and return to the shop owner and get back another thing. Some rules for the ordinary sale is like that. But the auction sale is different. If you get anything on auction, you cannot complain. Some repair is there, some defect is there, you have to return something, you cannot ask for a return of anything, replacement of anything. Because it was sold to you with all its defects. I am selling the thing, I am sell on auction with all its defects. That's the rule of auction sale. So here, with all our defects, at any time we can be enlightened. So I have such kind of defect, I have such kind of problem, nothing is needed, nothing is worried, nothing can be taken into account. With all our defect, we can be liberated, we can be enlightened. The flowing alone is must be there. It is already flowing. But if you select something, this must be like this, this must not be like this, that alone is not correct. We have to accept ourselves wholeheartedly, totally. If we select ourselves, this is good, this is bad, then we are creating some choice, creating some struggle within ourselves. So you have to accept yourself wholeheartedly with all your defects. Some emotion may be good, some emotion may be bad. But in the eyes of reality, in the eyes of liberation, in the eyes of enlightenment, everything is good, everything is real, everything is natural. You need not worry of anything. We need not worry about any of our emotions. We need not feel guilty of or anything. In each and every religion, to eradicate the guilty feeling, they have some strategy. When in Hindu religion, if you take bath in Ganga River, all your sins will be pardoned, all sins will go away, you will be forgiven. In Christianity, if you seek for the, if you give pardon for everything, if you put down every sin, if you're, what is the known as? In English? Confession. If you state, if you give a state of confession that I have done this sin and everything, it will be pardoned. Is it true? For example, one person committed a murder. The police rush after him. He falsely ran away and jumped into the river of Ganga. I have taken bath. Nobody should arrest me because all my sins were pardoned, all forgiven. The scripture says like this, why should you arrest me after taking bath in the Ganga? So all these things are related only. So cycle, whatever may be the guilty, you might have committed a wrong, many things. But everything is past. You should not feel guilty for anything. So that is the reason behind the confession or the forgiven or the taking bath in the Ganga River. Everything is only on the connection. Psychologically it is okay, it is correct, 100% correct. There is no wrong in it. But it is not taken into account in the physical manner. So psychologically, we should not be responsible to do anything. We have to put down all our responsibility. We have to leave our mind in a natural process. If it is moving on the natural process, just like a living river, everything will be washed away. Nothing will stay there. So if you raise any question, we may discuss on those lines.
This experience is that like Atma Sakshatkar, like we cannot experience it. But all these saints, like the great saints like Ramana Maharishi and other enlightened people, they experienced something and then they turned into a different person altogether. What was that experience then, if it is not possible to have?
So Ramana Maharishi himself said, nobody can experience Atma. He even, Ramana Maharishi himself said like
that. So my question is like, what is that experience then? If that is
so in the form, but anyhow, what they experience is only consciousness. All experience are consciousness. For example, if you feel I am, we can feel something. If you look at yourself, you can feel something. That feeling of something is known as consciousness. thy consciousness is a consciousness. You can feel something, you can know something. During some meditation or anything, you can feel something. So whatever you feel is consciousness. It is not, but everything beyond the consciousness, on the basis of consciousness, awareness is there. Without awareness, nothing is possible. No consciousness is possible without awareness. So awareness is the basis, Atma is the basis. But here, the purpose of introducing Atma is to delete the consciousness alone, not to feel the Atma. But we are mistaken that as if we have to feel Atma, we have to enjoy Atma, we have to taste Atma. That is impossible. No scriptures say we can feel Atma. Even scriptures say that you have to know Atma by Atma itself. You can aware Atma by Atma itself. We cannot, but we are consciousness. What we feel, what we handle, we can operate. What we operate is only consciousness. Consciousness cannot feel the Atma. Consciousness cannot feel the awareness.
Their final experience was losing the consciousness itself.
Only all experiences are only conscious level. There cannot be any experience. If it is in the form of experience, it is a consciousness. Consciousness means it has some appearance and disappearance. There is no unappeared consciousness, undisappeared consciousness. There is no such thing. Everything has to disappear. All consciousness has to go. All appearance, all experience has to go.
Like Ramana Maharshi, Buddha, so up to today, they were in some kind of state. They realized or experienced something. Then they changed the next moment, they changed it to something else. So what is that experience?
So that I have explained in the first day session. And he was not, if you listen to the video, you can understand like this. So Ramana Maharishi got the fear of death, and he allowed the fear of death. When you allow your the function of your mind, naturally the liberation will be there. Whoever allows their mind, naturally they feel the liberation.
It's the dropping of consciousness.
Dropping of?
Eye consciousness.
Not only eye consciousness, whatever it be, in the everything goes away. That means you allow yourself, you allow everything to pass away from yourself.
So the minute they felt that this is the truth, the next minute they changed, when they realized.
It begins to function in a different dimension. So self-responsibility, if you don't have any responsibility to shape yourself, that is a dissolution of the eye consciousness. Otherwise, but whenever you have the thought, naturally some eye consciousness will be there. There cannot be any thought without eye consciousness. So if you have thought, naturally you will have eye consciousness.
Dissolution is also at a psychological level.
The psychological responsibility, dissolution of the psychological responsibility alone is the dissolution of eye consciousness.
It is not something at the energy level or some other level.
Not love, only in the intellectual level.
Because most of us were mistaken to believe that it is at some other level, it's not psychological level. That's what we thought.
No.
Many people think so, actually.
But anyhow, when there is no responsibility to shape yourself, naturally the function of our mind will be in a different plane. So it may be look as if some energy change in within yourself, but it is not energy one. Whatever comes, it goes away. Previously, you manipulate everything, you regulate everything. Now you give freedom to everything. So everything function on its own. Previously, you make it function. Now you allow it to function on its own. That is the difference.
Tamil conscience.
உணர்ச்சி அல்லது உணர்வு அப்படி ஏதாவது சொல்லிடலாம், உணர்ச்சின்னு சொல்லலாம்.
மனம்ங்கிறது வேற, உணர்ச்சிங்கிறது வேற.
மைண்ட் மீன்ஸ் டோட்டல், டோட்டல். This is some specific some part of the mind. Feeling is a part of the mind.
Ayya, so this consciousness is short-lived, it's anicca.
Yeah.
Yes. Now, do you mean that this I consciousness is ego? Is this ego?
Yeah, everything. I come, whatever may be the consciousness, whether it is in the form of I consciousness or in the form of some emotion, everything is short-lived, momentary.
Yeah, but is that what you mean by ego?
Everything is, that is ego. But whenever it is appearing, it takes the role of ego. But at the same time, ego means some adamant nature also it may mean. That is a different kind of emotion. In the emotion level, if we give some importance to the I consciousness, and if it can be considered as ego, if it is related to the external world is concerned, how you behave. Your behavior level is related to the external world. You have to give some place to other person. You have to give some regard to the other person. That means related to the external circumstances. There we can consider, if you are adamant nature, if you do not give importance to other people, then we can take it as an ego. But it is related to the external world. But psychological world is concerned, there is we should not separate it as an ego. The I consciousness and ego is same in the psychological world. Not only the responsibility also goes away. The responsibility is the important thing. We have to give put down the responsibility. Almanam is the deeper conscious mind. Subconscious mind is our character, siddham. பொதுவாக நம்ம ஒரு விளக்கத்துக்காக பல விதமாக இப்போ இது பண்ணுறோம், அந்த டைமுக்கு அப்படி சொன்னால் சரியாக இருக்கும்னு சொல்லி சொல்கிறோம். இது மொத்தத்தில் என்னென்னு சொன்னால் எல்லாத்தையுமே மைண்டுன்னு தான் சொல்கிறது. இப்போ இறைவனை கூட காஸ்மிக் மைண்டுன்னு தான் சொல்லுவோம், பிரபஞ்ச மனம்னு சொல்லுவோம். எவ்ரிபடி இஸ் என்லைட்டன்ட், ஸோ நோ க்வெஸ்டின். So everything is only for the beginners. As a beginner, we can practice anything. As a Sakshi Bhava, we can practice choiceless awareness, we can practice everything, you can practice. But as a beginner, as an entertainment, you can have fun, you can have some meditation, you can have some practice or anything. But I have also taught three form of meditations. But if time permits, we may also take in some video clippings for meditation itself, because some beginners it may be helpful. If time permits, we can have three kind of meditation. But it is not useful for this class, this enlightenment liberation purpose, it is not useful. But for the beginners. So it looks like that, because our memory pattern, we should not be without our memory. So even though each and every moment some new thought comes, that is a scientific one. But even though the thought alone is the reason for the I consciousness, so naturally we have to infer. But at the same time, it will look as if it is a continuous one. Gap. Naturally, some gap must be there, because each and every one is a new one, fresh one. Naturally, some gap will be there. But we cannot perceive, we cannot feel it. Because of our memory, even though some gap is, the memory continues, giving a continuity to each and every thought. So we took ourselves as a continuous person from childhood onwards. Continuity. It looks like that.
But actually each moment I have been changing, now also I'm changing.
Yeah, changing.
By talking also.
Yeah. Each and moment by moment a new thought alone has come. That is the fact, that is the science. But anyhow we cannot understand, we cannot feel. That is also a science. That is also a fact. So we can infer, we can understand, and with the help of understanding we can infer like this. Otherwise we cannot feel.
So the inferer is called Atma?
No, infer is all, it is also another kind of thought. It is also a thought.
Okay.
The thought also infer. The inferring person is also thought. we do everything only with the help of our thought. So samadhi, different kind of some conscious, someone thought alone will be absent, but other in the other form of our mind will be awakened. We have some awakening, but our thought will not be there. So we have some awakening of our mind will be there, but no thought will be there. So we cannot feel anything in the samadhi state. No consciousness, because whenever this thought, when there is no thought, there is no eye consciousness. We cannot recognize anything, we cannot feel anything, but some blunt feeling will be there, but we cannot feel anything. For example, you are in a dark room, you cannot feel, you cannot look anything. But at the same time, you are available, that you are, you can feel yourself. You can feel yourself, but you cannot see anything. So in this way, the samadhi state itself, some feeling will be there, but we cannot understand anything. Even yourself itself, your eye consciousness itself. Some feeling will be there, some blunt feeling will be there. In the deep sleep, nothing will be there. But sometimes some persons, for example, there are certain persons who are having some subtle body, come away from the physical body through subtle body and return to the physical body. Certain people are there. They can come away from the physical body and return to the physical body. So if you have the capacity like that, during your sleep itself, they can have some different kind of activation in your subtle body. Thereby, you can watch even the sleep itself. So, for such people alone, they can have the feeling like this. But other ordinary people, normally it will not have. But some special sensitivity will be developed for those persons. But it is normal. It is not normal.
Can you?
No. I have no cover. I have no idea. I have no personal experience like that. But there are many persons with me. Some person have the same experience like this. Ariduil.
So when I am so what happens is, after some time one tries to ignore the thought, You know, so there is a suppression of thought and, okay, forget the thought, that is not real. This is real. I am sitting. So keep focusing on that. So, I mean, that kind of leads to a state of mind which I don't think is, I mean, I don't know. What is your opinion about that?
So here also, it is a kind of thought, but the thought is not wandering. It is circling yourself alone. So it is a different kind of thought. You are giving some access to circle yourself alone, to the feeling, what a sensation, and you keep the thought within the sensation level alone, and you are not. It is not wandering. So it is a kind of thought. It is also a thought level, but at the same time, you are giving importance to the some consciousness. So it is only for the some yoga practice, some energy. You are creating some energy field, and you are attending. You are having some focusing your attention to that. So the attention keep on going within yourself. So it is some practice.
But it is not a good practice. I mean, you would not.
So as a beginner, you can do.
Yes.
It may be considered as a good one, but as it is only for the beginners. But afterwards, the understanding alone will help. Nothing to do psychologically. Then only it will ends in liberation. Otherwise, this will not end in liberation.
Yes, it will be
doing the same thing again and again. It is a maintaining a state.
My question was similar to hers, but I will adjust it a little now. Does this mean that this understanding you call enlightenment, that is outside of consciousness, then you will never have an experience of this understanding, because then it's inside of consciousness and it's another thought. Is this how to understand this?
So here we have to understand, we should not take any shape, we should not entertain any shape for our consciousness. We have to accept our consciousness in whatever it may be the form. Whether it may be in the form of some emotion, good emotion, bad emotion, we have to accept it wholeheartedly. We should not have any stand for ourselves. I must be this, some peacefulness, or some good energy level, or some bliss consciousness. If you try to keep ourselves in a good state, that means we are selecting some consciousness. But here we are accepting wholeheartedly everything. It may be in whatever it may be the form, it may be in a good form or bad form. We are not selecting any consciousness. We are selecting all, we are accepting all consciousness. Everything is good. Everything is right. Everything is natural. We are not selecting anything. We are accepting is totally. We are not partially.
Try another formulation. And so this enlightenment, you say, is the knowledge that leads to liberation.
So yeah, that means when we understand, when we accept everything wholeheartedly and we allow it to function, when we allow it to function totally, it freely moves. The free movement of our consciousness, the free movement of our mind is the liberation. It ends in, because this happen only because of our understanding, only because of our enlightenment, then only we allow the natural function of our mind. Otherwise, we will not allow the mind. We try to control our mind, we try to shape our mind. So whenever we understand, we have no business within the mind, we accept everything as it is, then only we give freedom to our mind. Otherwise, we will not give freedom. Only because of our enlightenment, we give freedom to our mind. So when we give freedom, the mind functions in freedom. That is liberation.
That means that this thing you call understanding is not something. Normally I would say, I understand something, that is a thought I have. I can understand why a dog is running away from something, for example. I say, I understand this, I have this thought. But in this case, the understanding that leads to liberation, that is not a thought and not inside consciousness. Is this correct?
So liberation is the happening. It is a natural happening. In the liberation, anything may happen. Anything may move. So the movement, the free movement of the mind, within the, in the mind, some good thing may go, the good thing may move, bad thing may, everything, whatever may be the reaction of the circumstances, everything moves freely. But what the crucial thing is that the deciding, we decide, we decide work in the mind. So we have to come to the conclusion. It is only intellectual conclusion. There is no deeper level of conclusion. Only superficial and intellectual conclusion is enough. Our conclusion must say we have no work in the within the mind. When we understand like this, we do not do any work within our mind. We allow the mind to flow on its own, and the mind will flow on its own. So, but we have to come to a conclusion. The conclusion is enlightenment. A thought level, only superficial level. But at the same time, we should not be any doubt upon our understanding. If you have some confusion, it may be like that. If you think like that, it will not work. It must be wholehearted, it must be conclusive. The understanding must be conclusive, but it is only superficial and thought level. It is enough.
On the mind level, does that thought on the mind level also have some movement in the body? Is there a corresponding sensation in the body?
So whenever we have what kind of thought you are having, naturally it creates some energy.
Yes.
For example, when you think of a snake, naturally you will have some adverse feeling.
Yes.
So somebody, if you think of your son or some lovable person,
yes,
naturally you will have some sensation according to that.
Right.
So whatever may be the thought, we will have the sensation.
Okay, okay. But we don't pay attention to any sensations. We just keep on working on the fact that this is a flow.
This is a natural thing.
Yeah.
We have to, but here we should not take any stand. We should not try to keep any emotion permanently for ourselves.
Right.
It is impossible. So the possible thing is to, everything is to free flow. That is the natural thing. We should not give importance to lock any emotion. This is a good emotion, I must lock with me.
Right.
If it is a bad emotion, I will drive away from me. So whatever may be the emotion, it has to natural access from yourself.
Right. So when you say it is moment by moment, so for example, if I take one inhale, one exhale, okay?
Mm.
This is moment by moment. I am purposely moving my energy or the into focusing on the breath. Rest, like you said, 10 breaths. I'm regulating the breath.
In the breath. Mm.
Yeah.
Mm.
So for example, if I do that for 1 hour, then I do it for, like in meditation camps, you actually do 10 hours a day.
Mm.
Now, what I've understood from what you is that this is an unnatural state. This is not, because you are creating an energy inside, which is not the way it's supposed to be.
Mm. But sometimes some practice may help for your health. If it is helpful for your health, you can continue the practice itself.
How can it help my health? Because it's unnatural.
So even though it is unnatural, but for example, your eating is it is not natural. You yourself manually eat something.
Yes.
It is even though it is unnatural,
right,
it is not natural. So inhaling and exhaling may be natural, but eating some food is unnatural. But anyhow, you can select the food which is suitable for your health, suitable for your digestion, that you can select. In this way, some respiration, you can watch something. Sometimes it may be helpful. Everything has some limit. If you within the limit, everything may be helpful. Even during meditation, you may have some bliss consciousness. If it is within a limit, it may be helpful for the health of your body itself. But if it goes beyond limit, then it begins to destroy the body.
Yes. There is a disturbance of energy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, there could be some jerking, there could be some excessive energy buildup.
Yeah, okay.
Then we know that we had, then it is excess.
Excellent.
Then we can.
Oh,
yeah, we can stop
it. Within the limit,
yeah.
When it is helpful, you can make use of that.
Yeah.
One question is rather outside the syllabus, but nevertheless, it's part of my life. This question is on Saguna Bhakti. Saguna Bhakti in the sense, see, I'm from a Brahmin family. Right from the beginning, I was born with the grace of Venkatramana. And near our house, there is one Devi temple. It is said that there is Devi Sanchara, Devi goes there. So many people have said that they see Devi around in the midnight. So even I used to go in the midnight to see whether I can see Devi. So 3 times I walked that path. Third day I got a dream from that Devi saying, I'm not going to give you darshan because you still believe in human beings, something like that. So what I'm asking is about the Saguna Bhakti, like we still relate to Venkatramana as our family deity, Kuladeva and all, that is not connected to this, I suppose.
For the external world, you may have even Saguna Bhakti also, you may have. You may put your responsibility to the God, deity or anything. But in the psychological world is concerned, surrender alone is helpful for liberation. Here, surrender. Put down your psychological.
Without deity, rather. Deity is like outside.
Something working or anything, you can have some relationship. Everything must be within your limit. Then it is all right.
Because we usually go to Kula Devata or Gram Devata and all that.
Within a limit, you can have. Make use of that.
But within the psychological surrender itself is the
psychologically, surrender to God means same. Surrender to God and enlightenment is same.
Oh.
You have to put down your psychological structure totally and entirely into the hands of God. That means you put down, you have no work there. You put them everything in the hands of God or in the hands of nature. You have no work there. So psychologically it is so.
So actual surrender is the key. To whom you are surrendering is secondary.
Right? Yeah. So we can finish now.